book of John. We will be reading book of John, chapter 6, verses 60 through 72. On hearing it, many of his disciples said, "This is hard teaching. Who can accept it?" Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, "Does this offend you? What if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was seen before? The Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you are spirit, and they are life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe." For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray him. He went on to say, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled him." From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. "You do not want to leave too, do you?" Jesus asked the 12. And Simon Peter answered him and said, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." Then Jesus replied, "Have I not chosen you, the 12? Yet one of you is a devil." He meant Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, who, though one of the 12, was later to betray him.
Thank you, Phil. What an exciting time. All kinds of stuff is coming up. There's going to be the Harvest Festival. Going to be Saturday. That's an exciting time. Be able to bring your kids, or if you don't have kids, be able to come and watch everybody else's kids get all that candy. And then you can just bring the candy. And you know what? If you come at from 4:30 to 7, you can eat all the candy you want. There's a whole lot of games that are planned and things to be able to do here, and so it's going to be a great time for families, a great time for kids, a great time just for any of you. And so with that being said, we're also needing a lot of help and for setting up and cleaning up. This is for the whole neighborhood. We're trying to invite everyone in, and so it takes a lot just to be able to put all of this on. And so if you can help with that, be sure and sign up in the back. If you don't sign up in the back, just come and say, "Where do you need me?" And there's probably going to be some places where we're going to need you. So sign up if you can. That always makes things a whole lot easier because that works a lot better. Mission Sunday is the week after that. So that's going to be an exciting time. I see we've already got some things up here, but there's parts missing. You see an ox about this tall, let me know. He appears to have wandered off somewhere. I'm not sure where he's gone. Check under your pew. But that's always a great time when we're able to talk about the work that's been going on for the whole past year. I mean, you know a lot of things, but just seeing it all together, it's always impressive what God's been able to do and what you've been able to do by being able to give funds so that these people are able to do so many things. All right, so today I want to talk about finding Jesus among his followers. Do we do that? Can we find that? As you look back at the Bible, I think a lot of times we think today is worse than it ever was. I'm not so sure. Because you look back at the passage that was read for us in John chapter 6, and he really talks about this time when he had fed 5,000, and then they kind of want more, and can't we get more, you know, lunch? That's what you're here for, Jesus. And that's really not what he's here for. And he's trying to teach them about what it means that he's the bread of life. He's come down out of heaven. He's there for them. And they need to take him into their life. It's so close with them that it's almost like if you would, you know, you eat your food and it becomes part of you. He says, I need to become part of you. I'm the thing that nourishes you. I'm the thing that fulfills you. I'm the thing that makes it all make sense. And you really need all of that. And you need me to be that close. And so they get it. They say, we don't understand what you're talking about. And he tries to explain harder. And it's like, well, you need to, you know, take me into your life. It's like, I'm your food. I'm the thing that sustains you. And they're still not getting it. And so he talks about, it's like eating my flesh. That's what I would give you. And drinking my blood, because my blood gives you life. And they're going, now we're the cannibals. We don't think so. This is too hard a teaching. And sometimes the harder you try to explain something, the worse it gets. Have you ever had that? It doesn't matter what you say, that you keep going over it and over it and over it, and you're just not getting anywhere because they're really not understanding. And it may not be in your explanation. It may be in them that's blocked it. But some way there's a disconnect between the two. And I think we often see that with God and with Jesus. Because they're trying to explain things that are so simple and yet so profound. And we seem to not understand what it is that they're talking about. And so this passage, as you look at what happens, a lot of them, once they hear this, they're going, well, we don't get it. We don't understand it. And frankly, it's just too hard. And so they decide, we don't need this anymore. And they just decide they're not going to follow anymore. They're not going to do it anymore. And so they walk away. Notice many of his disciples turned back. This is not just a crowd. This is not just people who wandered by and says, oh, I think we'll visit this church today. This is his disciples, people who have been following him. It's not the 12, but it's people who have been following him, and they turned back and said, no, we don't quite understand. Wow. That's got to be hard. I mean, he had a whole bunch of followers who were there because of all the miracles he'd done, because of all the teaching he's done, and then he does this huge miracle of being able to feed, you know, 5,000 men plus women plus children, 75,000. No, I don't, that's probably too high. But, you know, there's probably at least 15, maybe 20,000 people out of 5 loaves and 2 fish. And when he tries to explain what the miracle means, they say, we don't get it. We're leaving. That's going to happen. Why did Jesus let that happen? Can't he do a better job of marketing? Can't he somehow make this work better? After all, you're the Son of God. I mean, if you're the one who can't speak and hold people's attention and get them to follow you, then how do you ever expect us to be able to do that? And he turns back to his disciples and he asks the question, are you leaving too? And their answer is always interesting. Where would we go? You have the words of eternal life. Beyond all that's nothing. There's nothing else there. There's no one else to go to. There's no other place. There's no other thing that would give meaning to life other than you and other than what you have to say. And I don't know that they understand it all. Do they have a greater understanding than the others? I think they understand one thing. This is the Son of God. And whether they understand all the doctrine about it or what taking his flesh and drinking his blood and his bread of life that's come down out of heaven, could they have given that sermon again? I don't know that they could. I mean, they will. But not yet, perhaps, because they haven't really figured quite how all this works, but they know one thing. is the Son of God. We don't have anywhere else to go. He has the words of eternal life. So what does Jesus do for the other ones? How does he get them back? He doesn't. Well, if Jesus can't get them back, then we don't either, do we? People come to faith and they're able to understand and they're able to believe and they're able to see what's important, but then when they decide they're not going to follow, he isn't going to change the rules. He isn't going to relax anything in his teaching. He's not going to do something different that makes him easier to accept. He's not going to say, I'll just dumb it down, so we'll just have lunch every day and sneak in communion during lunch. And that's not what he's doing. And so as you look at that, you watch some of these things when they walk. In fact, all of them seem to run away at one time or another. All of his disciples left at the time of his arrest. You look at what happens with Peter's denial. After he's been crucified, he's come back and they've seen him, but they just decide, well, where do we go from here? We don't know where to go from here. And so they go fishing. It's back to business again. I guess we go back to our jobs, we go back to our lives, and we do the best we can with it. And Jesus shows up on the shore, and he has all the fish. He says, you don't have any fish, do you? No. Try the other side of the boat, as if fish only swam on one side of a boat. Any boat I've ever been, they avoid both sides of the boat. I don't know why that is, but one side's never better than the other. But he gives them all the fish. They come up. He's already fixed breakfast. He's there with them saying, I am still here. That's when he asks Peter, do you love me more than these? There's a job. I want you to feed my sheep. He's there with them. They knew he was coming. They knew the Messiah was to be there. The whole nation had been looking forward to him for so many years. For thousands of years, they're looking forward to this Messiah who would come and who would deliver them, who would be this great leader like Moses. Is that far back? And he hadn't come. And now here he is. And they don't know what to do with him. Quite understand. Is it any different today? Grace and forgiveness are preached throughout the whole world. And is it any different today that some will follow and some will not? That's part of why I want you to be here in a couple of weeks for Mission Sunday, just to be able to hear about what's going on all over the world, because there are people of faith all over the world, and there are amazing things that are happening. There are amazing things that God is doing. And I think we need to know about that. We need to hear about that. We need to be able to say, yes, God's alive and God's working. And you're going to hear about a lot of things that day. It's one of those great things. Can we find Jesus among his followers? Well, looking back at the early disciples, it's kind of sketchy, isn't it? You would think it'd be a positive. Absolutely, these people believed forever, and they always did what was right, and you know what? They seem to be people like us. And so when you start looking at that, the inner circle would run away, and his closest disciples were going to disappoint him. They're always arguing about who's the greatest. I'm better than you are. I can do bigger miracles than you can. I don't know what the argument's about or how you prove you're greater than another disciple, but that's what they were arguing about. And they get afraid to ask questions. They don't always understand things. They don't always know things. They still think he's restoring the kingdom to Israel, even after he's died on the cross. But in Acts chapter 1, they're still all together. And they're in an upper room, and they're praying. And Jesus is there. He came back to see them all, in spite of the fact that they have doubts, in spite of the fact that they wonder. Because they do believe that God is in this world. They do believe God created this world. They do believe God has a plan for this world, and they are part of that plan. They believe in something better than what what's been going on, and they follow so that what they are doing is better than what other people expect. They give their best. They recognize God does that, that that's the way in which they should live their life. Even when Jesus goes to the wedding feast and the whole thing with his mom about making more wine, it's the best wine. And the ministry that they do is always the best, and they realize we've got to be above what's normal. We've got to be above some of the things that are just ordinary. And Jesus always was doing that. He took care of people, but the way he took care of people was, it was incredible. It was always the best. It wasn't about who they were. It was about what he was able to do. And that exceptional quality of kindness you see transferred over as the church begins. And as they begin to take care of people themselves, some who didn't have what they needed, they hold each other accountable. They join together in the work. And from Pentecost on, you see all of them working together in all of these different areas. It's amazing to watch what happens there. Jesus had told them, here's the mark of a disciple in John 13, before he had died on the cross. He said, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. It's simple, right? All we have to do is love each other. Well, I'm easy to love. Some of you guys, not so much. And there seems to be the problem, isn't it? We all think we're the ones that's easy to love, but everybody else, maybe they're a little bit different. So they'll know you're Christians by your love. And it's different in extent. That's why it's a new commandment, because it's not to love like I want to be loved anymore. It's to love like Jesus did love me. And what he did was so much more than the way in which I would even want to love somebody. It's because he gave up everything. He gave it all. And he says that's how you know what disciples are. It's a difference in the quality of how they love. It's a difference in the quality of everything that they do. They're always living a step ahead and a step above everything else. And I think that's one of the things that we see as we look at all of these things. Were they perfect? Not at all. Did they always follow? I don't think so. But as you look at what happened, the ones who were disciples were, it's amazing how much they were able to love other people and how much they were able to do for other people and how they solved problems. It's amazing to watch at the things they did. In Matthew 5, he begins to talk about some different things about how they should be as Jesus teaching. He ends the whole thing with love your enemies. Well, that's a whole lot more love than what most people expect. It's hard enough to love friends. Some of them are just difficult enough, but now I've got to love not only friends, but also enemies. And he said, so that you will be like your Father in heaven, because he loves that. And so as you look at the marks of what a disciple really is, and you look at some of the reactions that you see, it's not a reaction love, it's a decision love. I love because I have chosen, I'm going to love you. And that's really what they're saying. I'm going to love you, I'm going to do this, and this is what I want. And so it's not just a matter of, well, you're kind of nice, I like you, and if you're nice enough, well, then I'll say, okay, I can love you. No, you're going to love regardless of anything else. But it's not only that love reaction. He taught them about anger and about temper. And he said, you know, we don't have this. I don't want you calling people names. I don't want you to be angry with them. I want you to solve all of those things, because the child of God doesn't have those things. Don't let anger get in your way. Christians live above the world. And he talks about lust, and he talks about relationships, and that idea of sex has almost taken over our society. And he says, you know what, we stand above that. We don't get caught in that. We're not going to allow that to destroy us. Sex is for marriage, and it's for marriage with your, it's for with your wife, not just that you're married. Christians live above what the world does. And he says, that's a mark that you have. It's a way to see these people are different because they don't just follow society. Not only that, but they tell the truth. You can trust them. They're honest. Don't find that very much anymore either. They don't get insulted. At least they don't get in even when they're insulted. And that's what he seems to be saying with that. They don't retaliate in order to get even. And then they always do the extra. You know, they go with him 2 miles, even though only one was required. So they work different. They think different. They act different. They have their principles that are different. Are any of these huge things? Well, when you put them all together, it's huge. Because the way in which we would live our life is really a lot different. But there's not any one big thing that points to it and says, oh, look at that, they're all taller than everybody else. So it's not something that sticks out like that, but it's something that you can really see. The trend recently is to report how many churches are declining. I'm not arguing with that at all. That's true. We seem to be reporting that people are leaving and that everyone's doing it. So maybe you decide, well, okay, if everybody's doing it, I guess I have to. No. Absolutely not. Is that true for you? I think we have to make that kind of decision. Is that true for us? Is that what we're going to do? Is that what our church is going to be about? Or are we going to be people who say, you know what, we are disciples. And sometimes we have doubts, and sometimes the teaching's really hard. It has to be so hard to understand. He did in that auditorium, and man, he uses all those big words. But he's got a point. And if you stick with him long enough, you'll get the point of what he's trying to say. He's trying to say something important. He'll show you about God. But it's all of those things we go, you know, it's sometimes a struggle. Yes, it is sometimes a struggle. But where else would you go? This is the words of eternal life. It's found in his scripture. It's found from Jesus. We are his followers, and that's who we are. There isn't anywhere better to go. And the world does not offer a better solution for us. We do not see them. It might be a problem to find real disciples who will follow regardless. And there are disciples who will do that. And then there are disciples who will give up when it gets too hard. I'll come while it's easy. We need to be the real ones. I think one of the things that makes the whole difference in all of this is found in Matthew 11, verse 25. Jesus has been amazed that so few people understand. It says, at that time, Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to the children. Yes, my Father, such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father. And no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And so Jesus comes and he says some things are hidden. They're hidden from the wise. They're hidden from those who would think they can get knowledge by their own thinking and by their own logic. He says it doesn't really happen that way. It's got to come from God before life is ever going to make sense to you. But we keep trying at that and keep thinking, you know, we'll discover the secret of life by science. I'm not really sure you're going to find it by science, because God is the one who created science. And as you look at all these things, he's trying to draw this together. He says all of this comes from Jesus and the ones he chooses to reveal himself to. And he does choose that. He does choose to reveal himself. The question is, are we watching? Are we listening? We understand what he's trying to say, and he does all of these things too. And he says he wants the ones who are the tiredest. Maybe that fits you. He wants the ones who are struggling. He says, come to me when you've got all these burdens, when you're heavy laden, when you're weary, when there's been lots of pressure, when it's so difficult. And he says, I'll give you rest. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. We may look at that and go, I don't want any more burden. I've got all I can. But he says, you know what? This will balance it. This will balance your life. This will balance everything. And I will give you rest. You will find rest for your soul. And to me, that's the biggest mark of a Christian today. That you would find rest for your soul. Not the fact that we live different. Not the fact that we have different morals, different standards. Because sometimes we're going to fail at some of those things. But you know what? If you found rest for your soul, if you found peace in your life, you see so many people who are not finding peace whatsoever at all. They are there and they're rushing around. They're trying to get better. They're trying to get more. They're trying to be happy. And I would just buy some more happy and I would be filled and my life would be meaningful. And you don't buy more happy. The more stuff you get, the more insurance you have, the more you have to take care of it, the happier you are, right? No, it doesn't work that way. Because the happy comes from a different spot. It's from a different place. But when you find rest for your soul, to me, that's one of the biggest marks that you have people who have found Jesus, who have found that kind of rest. And their life may still be hectic. Their lives may still be going like crazy. But there's something different about them. They have found a peace in their life that passes everything else. They're able to follow Jesus and able to find rest on the inside. Peter writes about this later. He says, to this you were called because Christ suffered for you, leaving for you an example that you should follow in his steps. So we decide to let Jesus be part of the way that we live because he's the one who's called us. He's the one who has these answers. We believe in a creator and that there is a plan for this world. It's not just an accident that happened. That God does have a plan and we're part of that and the world around us is part of that. And he holds all of that together. And maybe it's not the big things that are noticeable, but our attitude is different. You walk around and you listen to everybody else and their attitudes are so bad. As if everything is owed to them, or if everything is wrong with them. It's either one way or the other. And there's always something that's not working or not going to work. Our quality of work is different because we work for Jesus, not just in order to get done and get out of there. And so you can see a difference in that. Our caring for people is different because we love different. We're able to see that. Our wanting to learn is different because we want to about Jesus and about who he is and about how he fills our life, and we grow closer to God all the time. And so it's not just a matter of today, but it's going to be a continual process of this spiritual awareness that makes us stronger and stronger in spiritual things. We see Jesus. We understand Jesus. We're not like the world that might follow and say, well, it was good for a little while and now I'll go. But we've really found this faith in Christ because we believe that he's the one who came, that he is secure, that he has been here forever, that God is in charge of all of this, and there is no other. There are no other answers out there anywhere because he's the one who made it all. It's time to decide. And maybe you're at that point where you're saying, you know, I've been wondering, is this really for me? Does it give me any benefit? Well, it does. If you invest in it, if you see what God's able to do, but it's kind of like everything else. You know, if you just kind of say, well, I'll watch it for a while, see if it does anything for me. I'm not sure it gives you anything. You can watch the stock market for a long time and somehow it doesn't send you money. You can, you know, watch athletes as they perform these incredible street feats of strength, and it doesn't make you any stronger. It's not until you start going and doing some of those things that it makes a difference in your life. And it's the same way with Jesus Christ. He's the one who makes all the difference. So don't give up on the learning part. Don't give up on the fact that sometimes it gets confusing or that other people seem to be walking away. It's only the ones who haven't found what they need and they don't quite understand. Don't let society or trends decide your faith or your future. That is up to you. And you'll find rest for your soul. You'll find peace in your life. You'll find a quality about you, an attitude about you, a caring, a love that's shared by everybody around you. And that makes an incredible life. Today, if you're on that edge and feeling like I need to know this, please talk to someone around you, or please come up here. If it's too scary to come up here, just talk to somebody around you. Find one of our elders. Be able to understand what this life is all about. If we are a